In the presentation, I'll be discussing the portable MEMS gravimeter that we have been developing at University of Glasgow. In the presentation, I'll briefly introduce gravimetry and its applications. I'll follow that introduction with a summary of the MEMS gravimeter that we are designing. We call it VG. There is a Scottish pun hidden in that. Maybe I'll let you guys to figure it out. And I'll present some experimental data that we have been gathering with these devices. And towards the end, I'll give a future outlook of our devices. So what is gravimetry? Gravimetry is a study of, it's a science, and it's used to study density anomalies in the ground. So for the same volume, denser objects will have larger gravitational pull compared to less dense objects. So if you have a gravimeter and you go across the surface, and if there is more dense, let's say rock underneath the ground, you'll see that the gravity, local acceleration due to gravity will increase. And by measuring the profile, you can actually image what's inside. Another example is in case of hydrocarbons. Hydrocarbons are pockets of organic gases and many times oil as well. They are covered by salt domes. So these are hollowed out structures. So if you are plotting, if you take gravity gradient across a salt dome, you'll see that there is a negative density anomaly, and your gravity profile will let you know. So it's very important in oil and exploration as well. Certainly there are other applications. Gravimetry has been used to monitor nuclear waste deposits in civil engineering, in security and defense. You can actually use gravimeters to detect hidden tunnels. It's used in volcanology. So you can have your gravimeters on, let's say, a volcano, and your gravimeter would be able to say would be able to detect any magma intrusion several kilometers underneath the volcano itself. Then it has some insurance applications as well. You can use gravimeters to detect sinkholes. And yeah. But the problem is, gravimetry is still not very widespread. It's not widely used. The reason being, commercially available gravimeters are very expensive and they are very large. For example, these couple of commercial gravimeters, FG5X and CG5, they are manufactured by Micro G Lacoste. They are very sensitive, so they can sense micro G, micro GAL of gravitational acceleration. So this is basically and they are financially risky to leave outside for long-term measurements. What we are doing at Glasgow, we are using standard microfabrication techniques to make MEMS gravimeters, and which have very similar sensitivities to what we have over here. So there are several kinds of gravimeters. There are free fall gravimeters. There are gravimeters based on atom interferometry. In our case, we are using a spring mass gravimeter. So on the left hand side, you can see the CAD of our device, and it's oriented vertically. So when there is any small change in G, the proof mass, which is sitting at the center of the frame, it displaces by a tiny amount. And you can, if you measure that displacement well enough, you can actually say how much G has changed. So to improve the sensitivity of such devices, what you need to do is either you want to have a soft spring and a large mass, or you can have a very good displacement sensor, or you can have both. But usually what happens is you are limited by your displacement sensor. So what you want to have is somehow have a very soft spring and a large mass. But again, we want to make it a packaged device. So we can't have literally kilos of mass. So we took another approach. So we basically used something called geometric anti-springs to reduce the stiffness of our device. Geometric anti-springs, this concept is not new. They are used in Virgo gravitational wave detectors. So these are used to suspend test masses in their Michelson interferometers. And by tuning the mechanical parameter, the geometrical parameters of your flexures, you can actually lower the spring stiffness. And there's another interesting thing about geometric anti-springs. As you load them, the stiffness, they go softer. So the more mass you put, the lower stiffness you'll get. So it's a win-win situation. Of course, you don't want to put in such a large mass that it completely collapses. So there's a limit to that as well. At Glasgow, we have been able to basically make devices which have very low resonance frequencies down to 1 hertz, which has not been shown anywhere else, with a 0.02 20 microgram proof mass. Fabrication is very standard. We used our DRI etching facilities at JWNC's, and you can see some SEM images of our flexures. They are, I think, 9 micrometer wide. We keep on tweaking the width of the flexures to get to the accurate frequencies that we want. But here's an example of 9 micrometer wide flexure. So fabrication wise, it's very standard, but it took a long time for us to actually optimize these processes. Now we have a proof mass which can respond, which has a very good high sensitivity. Now we have to basically match it with a very good displacement sensor. So we use optical shadow sensor. Optical shadow sensor are also inspired by shadow sensors which are used in advanced LIGO and gravitational wave detectors. So what you have, it's a very simple system. You have your proof mass in between. You shine a modulated LED light on from one end, and you have a split photo diode on the other end. So the proof mass basically casts a shadow onto your split photo diode. And when the proof mass moves, your shadow modulates, and you can read that modulation using a digitally implemented lock-in that we. There's a problem with gravimeters as well. Gravimeters are very susceptible to tilt. So if your ground is tilting, you are not actually measuring G. You'll be measuring a component of G. So these are the things which actually kill your gravimeters. So it's very important for you to, so if you're making a gravimeter, you either want to have a platform which is tilt stabilized actively or passively, or you monitor tilt and regress it out of your data. So regressing out of data is more mathematical. It's and tilt sensors are cheaply available. So we as the first solution, we were using that technique, that approach. So we are using some commercially like 50 pounds electrolytic tilt sensors. So after mounting our gravimeter and the readout electronics, we placed two electrolytic tilt sensors to monitor ground tilt in two orthogonal axes. Because our devices are made out of silicon. Silicon is it's not a good material if temperature is changing. So things become very unpredictable very fast. So it's very important to actually contain your environment. So what we do is we have made a small custom cube vacuum chamber. We mount our devices inside. We create vacuum inside, and we have attached several thermometers and heaters to accurately control temperature around MEMS. And the servo loops that we're using, can actually control temperature of MEMS within plus minus 2 millikelvins. So all these, on the readout side, of course, we have made our custom board. It has several DACs, ADCs. It's run by a DSP processor, and it has all the signal conditioning components on it. And you can log data, or you can transmit data wirelessly using this small board. So all these individual components we have placed on a small platform. So this is like a base 10 kg, 3.2 watts, can run on a battery, and we can do a lot of things with that. So for the measurements, so the first thing that we measured using our portable gravimeter is the earth tides. What are the earth tides? So earth tides are created by earth and moon gravitational pull. So they occur twice or once daily, depending on the phase of moon where it is. And these tides can actually can change the radius of Earth by several centimeters. So if our tides are high, wherever you're measuring your local G, you'll be moving by several centimeters away from Earth. So your value of G would be decreasing then. So earth tides are very good natural signals to validate your gravimeters, because you need to have very sensitive gravimeters to detect earth tides, and you also need to have a very stable very long-term stable gravimeters to continuously monitor them. In our case, we took our measurements over a period of 3 days in March, April, and earlier this year. So on the left-hand side, you can see time series of our experimental data. The red, the noisy thing that you see is the signal which is coming from the sensor itself, and the black line which is overlaid on top of that is the synthetic type that we generated using a software called T-Soft. So in T-Soft, you can put your latitude, longitude, your altitude, all those information, and it will give you a predictable, type. So we have overlaid over that. And on the right-hand side, you can see amplitude, spectral density, response of our devices. So at 1 hertz, we are getting 8 microgal. So 1 microgal is 1 nano G, 1 billionth of a G. So we are getting a sensitivity of 8 nano G over 2 hertz at 1 hertz. But at slightly higher frequency, you also see that our phase is slightly polluted. So this is because we are sensing microcyclic activity as well. And what are microcyclic activity? These are basically very tiny earthquakes which we never notice. So it could be because of some building work going on. Or in our case, it's basically because we are in class, so C is not very far. It's coasting rain, basically, C gets tracking on the shore repeatedly. And you can see that. Response on our ASC plot as well. Our sensor drift by about 345 nanometers a day. CG5 commercial gravimeter that I showed earlier. So that drifts by 500 microgal a day. So we are slightly better than that. These are tilt and temperature measurements for the same time period. So you can see our tilt actually changes over a period of 3 days. We are controlling our temperature. The temperature remains within 1 millikelvin, so that's very good for us. Our devices are, we are still trying to figure out how tilt sensitivity actually comes into picture. What is the mechanics of tilt sensitivity for our devices? So our devices are very sensitive in one axis and they are very less sensitive in other axis. So if our devices are deep like this, they are very less sensitive in this direction, but they are very highly sensitive to tilt in this plane. Apart from that, there are occasional earthquakes around the world, and it's always interesting to see other capabilities of our devices. So this is an example. There was a 7.9 magnitude earthquake in Alaska earlier this year, and we were able to actually measure the signal of that earthquake in class 2. And here's a comparison. So this seismometer reading is taken from an observation located in Scotland. It matches. The units are slightly arbitrary, so I won't compare them, but the response, the potential response looks pretty nice, not too bad. Now, of course, we have done other tests. So apart from measuring earth sites, we have taken our photographs from outside. So here is an example. We are going to a lift shaft, we are moving up and down between a few floors, and as we move away from the base, the lowest level, as we move away from us, your gravity was between this, and we were doing some repeatability measurements as well. So between these flows, we were sensing a change of 5 milligal, which is 5 micro G. So if we can take our devices in lift, why not take it over a hill? So we actually did some measurements. There are small hills around Glasgow. So we measured gravity at the base of the hill, we drove up, and we measured the gravity again. Now, interesting point aspect of this measurement is as we move away from Earth, we decrease, but because we're sitting on a huge hill, and that huge hill will have its own gravitational pull, so your gravity will slightly increase. So to estimate the deadlines that you see are a combination of both these effects. So the VA effect is when you move away, your gravity decreases, and pressure effect is basically local.
Yeah, I'm almost done.
So to conclude, we have developed a portable MEMS gravimeter platform which can be battery run, and it has a short-term sensitivity of 8 microgal or 8 nano G at over root hertz. We are using standard fabrication techniques, inexpensive electronics, blah, blah, blah. We have measured earth sites using this portable platform. I thank all our industrial collaborators and funding agencies. And future direction, the last slide. We are moving from optical shadow sensor because there is a limit to how much we can make it small. So we are going towards a capacitive and interferometer readout. And this is what we have in the recent, literally like a few weeks ago, we have fabricated our first batch of devices. And you can see the device in action, only if I can play it. Thank you so much.